Psalm 117 says, "Praise God, everybody. Applaud God, all people. His love has taken over our lives. God's faithful ways are eternal. Hallelujah." Then it moves on in Psalm 118, the words that have just been on the screen, and it says, "Thank God because he is good, because his love never quits." And this morning we are going to sing of that goodness, so I'm going to invite you to stand with us as we lift up the good name of God this morning.
The goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. I have lived in the goodness of God.
Let's pray. This morning we lay down our lives before you, God, in surrender, in response to your goodness. And we thank you that your goodness, your faithfulness, your love chases after us. Knowing that, we run towards you this morning. So we begin this journey on the road towards Easter as we reflect on who you are, on what you are about to do through your Son, Jesus. We give thanks. We give thanks for your goodness, for your love, for your faithfulness in our lives. And we give thanks because we know the end of the story. And because of that, we can walk in freedom and in hope because of you. Thank you, God. Thank you for your goodness. Thank you for your mercy, your faithfulness in our lives. Amen. Please be seated. Well, we want to say welcome to everyone who is here in person today. And for those watching along online, we say hello to you. And we hope you have a great time worshipping with us today. I want to take a moment to acknowledge the Barramadagal people of the Darug Nation and to pay my respects to their elders past, present and emerging as we live and work and worship on this land here in Parramatta. Well, I want to share with you just a few announcements. Don't worry, my list is not as long as last week, of the things that are coming up at Parramatta Salvos. And of course, the first thing we want to tell you about is all that's happening over our Easter weekend. So, it's going to come up on the screen, but we invite you to join with us on Holy Thursday. We're going to have a short reflective time together, journeying on the road to Easter. We'll actually be reflecting on some of Jesus' encounters with people before his death and actually questioning what they might have been feeling as they knew that Jesus was on this road towards his death. So it's going to be a great night of discussion, of prayer together. So we'd invite you to come 7 p.m. on the 28th of March, and it will just be a 1-hour service as we gather together. On Good Friday and Easter Sunday, we're meeting together for one service at 10 a.m. So the good news is if you go to the 9:30 and you turn up then, you'll be early. Bad news is if you come to the 11, you'll miss half the service. So make sure you're here at 10 a.m. We're also very excited to announce that our cafe is going to be open both before and after church on both of those days. So from 9 a.m, you'll be able to come and have a coffee before church, which is great news because public holidays, all the good coffee shops are closed, right? So come and get your coffee between 9 and 10 or then following the service as well. But we just want to invite you to take one of our Easter flyers. They're out in the foyer. Hand them out to friends, family, colleagues, and invite them to be here for the Easter weekend. Now, we just need to clarify the information regarding the seniors gathering. Our bad. The dates came out slightly wrong, but that's okay because we have sent this out. You should have received this via email, but this is all the dates for our seniors gathering this year, including the first one, which is actually next Wednesday at Club Parramatta at 12 p.m. So if you'd like to come along to that, I see there's already a bunch of people signed up on the list in the foyer. We'd invite you to put your name down for that. We're just joining together for a meal at Club Parramatta. There's plenty of parking down there, and you just come and buy your lunch and we're going to share that together. Finally, I just need to remind all the creatives in the room that on Wednesday night we have a combined rehearsal for Easter. So if you're part of the tech team, our ensemble or our brass band, we are gathering together from 7 p.m. It's all in at 7 p.m. and then from 8 p.m. or thereabouts, it will just be the ensemble. So if you're part of one of those teams, please make sure you are here on Wednesday night. Well, our kids are going to go off to Sunday Squad in a moment. Sunday Squad won't be on next week during our Easter meeting, so parents just prepare for that. We'll have heaps of colouring and things like that to do during the meetings. But have fun as you go off this week. Enjoy. Well, Kylie and I want to say thank you for all of those who contributed to our self-denial appeal this year. You might have seen in Parramatta's this week that so far we've been able to raise just over $38,000, which is incredible, towards this year's self-denial appeal. And if you miss the opportunity to give, that's perfectly fine. You can continue to do that for the next couple of weeks by placing your envelope in the offering basket or just coming and giving it to one of us. But we want to say thank you. Thank you for your incredible generosity to the self-denial appeal this year. And you know, as I was reflecting on our giving, as I was reflecting on my own giving last week, I thought to myself, you know, it's all well and good, those of us especially who give via credit card or electronically, when you put your envelope in the self-denial basket, it's not until a week or two later that it comes out of your bank account, right? And that's when it really stings. And I've just been thinking about that sacrifice and what that means for many of us, giving maybe 1 week's salary or a large portion of that to the self-denial appeal. And a little bit, I think it is meant to hurt a bit. It's meant to be a sacrifice for us to give in this way. But actually, it reminds me each and every time that that's not where I'm called to store up my treasures. Story in Matthew chapter 6, Jesus says, "Don't hoard treasures down where it gets eaten by moths and corroded by rust, or worse, stolen by burglars. Stockpile treasure in heaven where it's safe from moth and rust and burglars." It's obvious, isn't it? The place where your treasure is the place where you will most want to be and end up being. In the NIV, it says, "Where your treasure is, there your heart will also be." And so I've been thinking about that line. Where is my treasure? Where is my heart truly? Is it in material things? Is it in things that I can buy, stuff? Or actually, is it in the things of God? Is it in spiritual things? And so as you come and as you give your regular tithes and offerings today, I would encourage you to consider that question. Where is your treasure? Where is it being stored up? Where is your heart? I'm going to pray for us this morning as we come and give before Greg plays. Would you join me in prayer? A loving Heavenly Father, I want to thank you for the generosity of so many people in this room. Thank you both for their generosity in giving to those in need as we sacrificially give to the self-denial appeal. But I also thank you for the week in, week out giving of people as they lay down a portion of what they have. And they contribute to building the kingdom of God. And God, we pray that we would be people of generous hearts, that our treasure wouldn't be in material things, in the stuff that we have, but actually it would be in community, in being with you, in being connected with you. So we just ask that you would take what we give today, that you would use it, that you would extend your kingdom through it. May we be people whose treasure, whose hearts are truly with you. Amen. Would you come and give as the team plays?
Bible reading this morning comes from Mark chapter 11, and you will never guess what the story is about. A couple of clues here. Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem. Mark chapter 11, commencing at verse 1. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethpage and Bethany at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and just as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you doing this?' say, 'The Lord needs it and will send it back here shortly.'" They went and found a colt outside in the street, tied at a doorway. As they untied it, some people standing there asked, "What are you doing, untying that colt?" They answered as Jesus had told them to, and the people let them go. When they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks over it, he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, while others spread branches they had cut in the fields. Those who went ahead of those and those who followed shouted, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest heaven." Jesus entered Jerusalem and went into the temple courts. He looked around at everything, but since it was already late, he went out to Bethany and the 12. May God add a blessing to that reading this morning.
I'm going to invite the team to come and join me again. But I love that story and I love the words of the song that we're about to sing. It says, 1,000 generations falling down in worship to sing the song of ages to the Lamb. All who've gone before us and all who will believe will sing the song of ages to the Lamb. And it goes on to say, your name is highest, your name is greatest. All thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all. And this morning, I want to invite you as we sing this song. And perhaps from where you're sitting, you might see the road. And you might be able to connect with what it might have felt like on that day. Laying things down for Jesus as he came, crying out to him perhaps. And so I'm going to invite you to stand as we sing the words of this powerful song this morning. But if you can, maybe to turn and to look and just to visualize, to paint a picture in your mind of what it may have been like. Let's stand together and sing.
Stands above the law and the angels. Oh, Lord Jesus, we join with those people on that first Palm Sunday and sing Hosanna. You are holy. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the King. We lift you up. Speak to us now. We want to follow you. We want to worship you. Teach us how. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Those young people here may never have seen one of these. This one's a Gregory's, but I always remember being a UBD. And I was talking to Kylie, it was a Melways down in Victoria, but up here, UBD or a Gregory's. Now, just to explain for those younger people, every street in Sydney is in this book, or at least back every street that existed back in 2008 is in this book. And what I would do, say I was coming to your place, I'd never been to your place before, you'd tell me your address, and then I'd look it up. Your street is in here. And I'd find where it is, and then I'd find where I am and work out how to get there. And I used to try to memorise it so I could just drive there. But of course, that seat that you young ones know as shotgun was actually the navigator. And they would hold this map in front of them and say, turn, oh no, that one, as you would go past. Actually, that still happens, doesn't it? The important road, of course, was the one you were getting to, because there's always different pathways. And all those other streets are all helpful, but there's a road that you are getting to. Or useful. Of course, I use my phone now to tell me where to go, and I can never remember where it was. If you know, if your phone battery goes flat and you go, where am I? I have no idea where I am. That way you used to know where you are. You can still buy them, by the way. Did you know that? There's a 2023 edition out of a UBD, and I'm sure there's a 2024 one coming out soon as well. I don't know who buys those, but anyway, they're out there. The road is important, and the pathway you choose makes all the difference, doesn't it? If you're on the wrong road or going the wrong direction, you're not going to end up where you need to be. And we have this wonderful road marked out for us today. And Richard read to us from Mark's gospel of this road that Jesus chose. Now, I always believe when you read a verse in the Bible, you need to understand it within the passage. When you read a passage, you need to understand it within the chapter. When you read a chapter, you need to understand it within the whole book. And with the book, you need to understand it within the whole Bible. Don't worry, I'm not going to go from Genesis through to Revelation, but I am going to go back to the start of Mark for you. Mark was all about the road. The journey. Mark's one of those get there people, destination people. You know, there's two sorts of people, those who enjoy the journey and those who want to get there. And often you marry each other and it's an interesting journey. Mark's a get there person. Mark's gospel begins the gospel of Jesus the Messiah, the Son of God. If you ever do a Christmas sermon on Mark, that's all you've got. Because then he gets straight to John the Baptist. And even that's very quick. Because for Mark, he wants to get to the destination. There is a road to get to. And he does everything to get there. All the way through, Jesus performs a miracle. He says, and then immediately, he moves on. Jesus does some teaching. Then immediately, there's this action oriented all the way to follow to get to the road all the way through. In fact, as Mark goes on, you start to say, and Jesus set his face towards Jerusalem. Everything was towards a particular road. And the action is fast up until the beginning of Mark chapter 11, and then it slows down. And we read this incredible story of Jesus entering Jerusalem. And the heading, which Mark didn't write, someone wrote later, but the heading, which Richard did read for us, says, Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem. Isn't that a magnificent heading? Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem. Jesus goes and gets a colt, or at least his disciples for him. They put cloaks on it, so it's going to be a comfortable ride for him, as comfortable as it could be without a saddle. And then they put cloaks on the road. And people put branches, the palm branches, across the road. And there's people shouting out, The road that Jesus has chosen to enter Jerusalem is the main street. Let me give you some context. This was at Passover. Everybody went to Jerusalem for Passover, and everybody who was anybody entered through the east gate. People were no different back then to they are today. People liked to do celebrity spotting. And what they used to do was go to the east gate and stand there, because everybody's coming to Jerusalem. We might see someone famous. We might see a celebrity, one of those great teachers, one of the prophets, might be someone great. The king might come. And so people gathered around, all the visitors to Jerusalem, to see if they could see someone great. And along comes Jesus, riding on the colt, with his disciples shouting out, "Hosanna! Praise be to God! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord." What a fantastic, wonderful event. And everyone gets caught up in it. There's someone famous. Did you see him? This is the red carpet of Jerusalem. This is the event. And everyone is shouting his name. Even if they didn't know it beforehand, they said, "Who's that? Oh, Jesus, quick." And they start shouting out. What an incredible moment. The disciples must have felt pretty good at this moment, because up until now it had all been pretty quiet and they'd been in the countryside, and now they are important. Jesus arrives with an entourage. He's travelling on a colt in comfort and in style. And people are waving. They didn't wave flags, they waved branches, anything they could find. What an amazing entry into Jerusalem. And the people are shouting, Mark puts these words into their mouths. They are saying, "Hosanna, praise the Lord. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord." It is a direct quote from Psalm 118, verses 24 and 25. A direct quote. Now, you say, well, what's that mean? Mark's readers were quite astute, or at least Mark expected them to be. Psalm 118, in case you don't know, fits nicely between the shortest chapter in the Bible and the longest chapter in the Bible. It just sits in the middle there. A couple of verses earlier is the most quoted verse from the Old Testament in the New Testament. Just a side note. Psalm 118 seems to feature heavily in the New Testament. And Mark makes sure that's the psalm that they're quoting. That's what they're shouting out. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. What an amazing moment. I don't know about you, but I like moments like that. Like when people say good things about you. I love recognition. Don't you love being recognized when you do a good job, that someone recognizes it? It's one of the big things in management. Make sure you recognize when people do a good job. Because they feel good about themselves, they're more likely to do it again, right? Recognition is so important. I was just telling JB about a conference we've got coming up, and one of the evenings we have our Life Awards for our company, and we recognise people who've done great things. Recognition, getting an award, people shouting out your name, the celebrity, or if you can't be the celebrity, be the person standing next to the celebrity, right? It's wonderful. The disciples must have felt, this is the moment. And if it's the first time you've ever read Mark's Gospel, you go, this is the road that we've been working towards. This is the road. What a wonderful road. Everyone calling my name. You know the story. It's a great road, and we're all tempted to want to go down this road. Listen to what Mark says when they enter into Jerusalem. Remember this triumphal entry into Jerusalem? So Jesus came to Jerusalem and went into the temple. After looking around carefully at everything, he left because it was late in the afternoon, and he returned to Bethany with the 12 disciples. This is not the road we're looking for. What an anticlimax. Mark is incredibly understated, but he makes it clear. What was all that about? This is the triumphal entry. The editors who wrote and put that little heading, the triumphal entry of Jesus into Jerusalem, I think they got it wrong. This is definitely not a triumphal entry. This is not what Jesus came to do. We're called to follow Jesus. And if I'm really honest with myself, this is the road I'd like to follow him on. I know what it's like. I like praise. I like it when things are going well. I like it when people are on my side and agree with me. But this is not the road. We're going to see that other road on Friday. The crowds will change the tune. Instead of crying, "Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord," they'll be shouting, "Crucify him." The disciples will no longer be an entourage, but they'll have all disappeared, run away. Jesus will no longer be riding in comfort, but dragging a cross. That is the road he invites us to follow him on. That is the main road. Oh, we get excited today because I don't know how you felt, but as we sing, "Holy is your name," it's a good thing to sing, by the way. But Jesus didn't come to say, "Holy is my name." Jesus didn't come to glorify himself. He came in humility. Jesus didn't come for self, but came for love. He chose a different road. Psalm 118, the most quoted verse of the Old Testament and the New Testament, just a couple of verses earlier, verse 22, says, "The stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone." Jesus chose that road. See, the cross is over there, not here. Listen to what Paul wrote. "Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves, not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of others. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who, being in the very nature of God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself. He became obedient to death, even death on a cross." Jesus invites us to follow him. Sometimes I wish it was this road. But he didn't choose this road. I don't know what that means for you today. I don't know what struggles you've been going through and you're thinking, "I don't want those struggles anymore. I want this road." I don't know what's happening in your life, but I know some of my own stuff. I know sometimes after I've preached and people say, "Hey, that was great. You're a great preacher." I'm a bit on this road, right? And I sometimes go, "Oh, I don't want to be on that road." I've learned to say thank you when people say that. But I want to actually say, "Actually, I'm on this other road. I want you to notice Jesus, not me." You see, that's what this is about. I've decided to follow Jesus. Not this road where everyone's shouting. The road of humility. The road of love. And we can follow that road because Jesus has already gone that road. He's already passed that way because he loves us. Oh, Heavenly Father. That's a hard pill to swallow sometimes. But help us to choose the road of love. Help us to follow Jesus. as the group comes, we're going to sing just that. I want decided to follow Jesus. Christ is enough. And however you need to respond today, I invite you to do that. What's the Spirit saying about the road that you choose to follow?
Would you like to stand as we sing these words?
I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. The cross before
pray. Jesus, we thank you that you came not as someone that wanted the praise and the glory, but someone that came in humility. And this week, as we prepare our hearts to walk alongside you on that road towards the cross, we just pray that you would reveal more of who you are as you have done today. Show us your heart, Jesus. Help us to follow you. Help us to walk alongside you Help us to know you more and more. We ask this in and through your name. Amen. And I'm going to invite you to remain standing as we sing our last song this morning. We lift up those shouts of Hosanna. Palm Sunday benediction, passing from joy into sorrow and onto elation, we come to Christ this Holy Week. Today is only part of the story. Jesus' triumph leads to his death to his resurrection. May the journey of this week lead you into the fullness of Christ's love. And that is our prayer for you. We invite you to join us now for morning tea as we gather together. And of course, this week to join us on Thursday night and then Good Friday and Easter Sunday as we continue taking this journey together. God bless you.